just about wrapping up their deliberations and should be joining us here in a matter of a few minutes. And as soon as they get here, we will begin. They're almost here. thank the Jamaica military band under the baton of Albert Sean Hurd for keeping us entertained.
Thank you. Thank you.
Nous allons commencer à ce moment-là. Vamos a comenzar ahora. We'll begin in just a moment. Asiento, por favor. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, The heads of state and government and heads of delegation will enter the ballroom, each preceded by a cadet bearing the flag of each country in alphabetical order. The cadets participating in the flag mounting ceremony are furnished both by the 4th Battalion and Support and Services Battalion of the Jamaica Combined Cadet Force. The schools represented this evening are Cornwall College, Rosses High School, St. James High School, and William Nibb Memorial High School. We first of all welcome Antigua and Barbuda, the Honorable Gaston Brown, Prime Minister. Belize, the Honorable Margarito Gasper Vega, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Natural Resources. The Republic of Cuba. His Excellency Salvador Valdez Mesa, Vice President of the Council of State. The Commonwealth of Dominica, the Honorable Francine Baron, Minister of Foreign Affairs. The Dominican Republic, the Honorable Simón Lizardo Mezquita, Minister of Finance. The Republic of El Salvador, His Excellency Hugo Martinez, Minister of Foreign Affairs. Grenada, the Honorable Oliver Joseph, Minister of Economy and Development. The Cooperative Republic of Guyana, His Excellency George Talbot, Permanent Representative for Guyana to the United Nations, New York.
The Republic of Haiti, His Excellency Michel Martelly, President. The Republic of Nicaragua, His Excellency Daniel Ortega Saavedra, President. St. Kitts and Nevis, Dr. the Honorable Timothy Harris, Prime Minister. St. Lucia, Dr. the Honorable Kenny Anthony, Prime Minister. The Republic of Suriname, the Honorable Suresh Algo, Minister of Agriculture, Livestock and Fisheries. The Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela, His Excellency Nicolas Maduro Moros, President. Jamaica, the Most Honorable Portia Simpson Miller, Prime Minister. Please remain standing for the national anthems of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela and Jamaica.
Please be seated.
And please welcome the Honorable Philip Paulwell, Minister of Science, Technology, Energy and Mining, to deliver the welcome.
The Most Honorable Portia Simpson Miller, Prime Minister of Jamaica, His Excellency Nicolas Maduro Moraes, President of the Bolivian Republic of Venezuela, other heads of state and government, the Most Honorable Percival James Patterson, former Prime Minister of Jamaica, members of the Cabinet of Jamaica, visiting ministers of government, Your Worship, the Mayor of Montego Bay, members of the Diplomatic and Consular Corps, visiting delegations, distinguished guests, members of the regional and local media, ladies and gentlemen. Today we gather as representatives of PetroCaribe member states, and Jamaica is proud to host this, one of the largest grouping of sovereign states. Today is indeed a glorious day, a fitting commemoration of an historic event and a most compelling expression of appreciation by all signatories of the PetroCaribe Agreement. But more than that, this commemorative summit provides a profound opportunity for reflection on what can be achieved through solidarity and regional cooperation. So even as I welcome you to Jamaica and to this August event, I invite us to pause a moment to fully recognize the value that can be created, what can be achieved when we share a common cause, a commitment to the principle of collective action and mutually beneficial development. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the real achievement of PetroCaribe. That reflection and that realization will again silence those skeptics who said that the PetroCaribe could not last, those who prophesied that our dream of a sustainable and exemplary regional energy pact would dissipate into thin air. The energy initiative conceived 10 years ago, the achievements that we have shared, as well as the challenges that confront us, must now motivate us even stronger to resolve at development through solidarity. It is the 10th anniversary of the PetroCaribe Agreement, and not only has the historic pact survived, but the signatories of the agreement have increased. As participants, we have grown stronger, more cohesive, more collaborative, and increasingly mutually supportive of each other's development. In this regard, we have not only expanded the membership, but we continue to diversify our areas of cooperation from energy in goods and services. Pardon me if I take special pride on being here today, as I am the only minister with portfolio responsibility for energy who was present at the conception and birth of the initiative 10 years ago, and who is still in office as Minister of Energy. Therefore, my welcoming remarks would be incomplete without another short moment of reflection. Did I ever doubt the lofty goals of the arrangement? Never. Were there risks involved in its implementation? Certainly. However, with the enlightened leadership and steadfastness of all our leaders in the region, as well as the powerful enthusiasm of President Hugo Chavez Frias and now President Maduro, the ethos and the intent of PetroCaribe have and continue to thrive. Successive ministers of energy have given momentum to those efforts and have remained focused on the vision that inspired PetroCaribe. So here we are today. The resolve remains strong and true. The lessons of PetroCaribe remain indelible, and its responsiveness to the challenges of change remain absolute. Jamaica, like our other partners in PetroCaribe, can testify to the tangible benefits of the agreement. For all developing countries, energy is at the heart of economic development. This agreement has facilitated investments in infrastructure and human capital development to change the very lives of those most in need, in poverty alleviation, and it has financed pivotal investment in renewable energy, certainly here in Jamaica. This latter element supports an important strategy for developing countries, that of diversification of our energy sources to ensure both energy security and energy independence. As Minister, I must take the liberty of recognizing one remarkable achievement supported by the PetroCaribe Agreement, that of Wicton Wind Farm, now the largest of its kind in the English-speaking Caribbean. Of this and the other achievements in the sector, we are proud as a nation. We gather today not just to celebrate the success of the PetroCaribe Agreement on its 10th anniversary, with expectations for a brighter future, but with the popular sentiments of our people who have witnessed firsthand the strength of solidarity and experienced the goodwill of true development partnership. Venezuela has been a committed partner. Committed partners demonstrate their resolve when there are challenges and strain. It is easy to give rhetorical commitment when the wind is favorable, but when the seas are choppy, when there are several challenges and that commitment remains, it is then that you know you have a true partner. The spirits of Simon Bolivar and Hugo Chavez live. President Maduro breathes that same spirit and now carries on that centuries-old tradition of solidarity with his brothers and sisters of the region. Viva Venezuela. Welcome to you all.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we invite you to view a 4-minute video presentation on PetroCaribe.
Simón Bolívar arrived in Jamaica 200 years ago. He had been exiled and felt dejected. He had no means of support, but his desire for the Americas, which he called America, to be a great regionally integrated body was still very much intact. And in the midst of sorrow and defeat, he writes one of his most brilliant independence proclamations, the Letter from Jamaica.
More than anyone else, I desire to see America transformed into the greatest nation in the world.
The Liberator writes in this letter his deepest thoughts, analyzes the various American nations, and presents solutions. Eternal Commander Hugo Chavez Frias will implement those solutions, reflecting their scope and rightfulness. He dedicated himself to the continuation of the dream of the Liberator.
No somos ni africanos, ni europeos, ni americanos del norte. Somos una liga de todo eso y conformamos, decía Bolívar en su carta profética de Jamaica, un nuevo género humano, decía. Pudiéramos decir quizá más propiamente, no tanto un género, sino una civilización conformamos nosotros. Y esta reunión coloca esa bandera de la búsqueda o la necesidad de la búsqueda de nuestras raíces, de conseguir y buscar y conseguir los códigos de nuestro pasado para poder descifrar el presente y proyectar un futuro distinto, que ya no seamos más la frontera imperial.
Bolívar and Chávez, the same vision of unity, freedom, solidarity, and fair regional integration of the people takes shape in the PetroCaribe Energy Agreement.
Si el Libertador Bolívar, con su caballo y sus ejércitos, avanzó por todo el continente, él nos liberó, pero no nos integró. Y es el presidente Chávez, y es PetroCaribe, y es ALBA, y es CELAC, y es UNASUR, y es Venezuela con sus actividades, y cada uno de nuestros países con nuestras fuerzas, lo que va a dar el segundo paso, pasar de la liberación a la integración.
Hacemos realidad la visión de Bolívar para la unidad y para el desarrollo económico social en América Latina.
Este tipo de sistema nos va a permitir reducir la pesada carga que esto representa para nuestra pequeña economía. Gracias, presidente, por esta iniciativa y tenemos nuestra esperanza cifrada en que otros países podrán también beneficiarse de este mecanismo. Muchísimas gracias.
PetroCaribe endeavors to eliminate social inequalities. It fosters the improvement of the quality of life and the true involvement of the peoples in the shaping of their own destiny as free countries of the great United Latin America.
PetroCaribe ha sido y es el proyecto que en la historia del Caribe ha provocado mayores transformaciones positivas para la vida económica y social de nuestro pueblo.
En nombre del gobierno y del pueblo de la República Cooperativa de Guyana, quisiera aprovechar esta oportunidad para felicitar a PetroCaribe por sus logros a lo largo de estos 10 años. Nuestro país ha crecido enormemente gracias a los arreglos que se han hecho posible a través de PetroCaribe.
Today, we continue developing socioeconomic, technical, and infrastructure aspects to reserve this historical isolation and strengthen the sovereignty and energy security of the PetroCaribe Agreement member countries. It is the consolidation of the idea that the Liberator had 200 years ago.
And now, one of the founding signatories for the PetroCaribe Agreement, the Most Honorable Percival James Patterson, former Prime Minister of Jamaica.
The Most Honorable Portia Simpson Miller, Prime Minister of Jamaica, President Maduro Morris of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela, Presidents and Prime Ministers, representatives of heads of state and government, ministers, mayors, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it was El Comandante who, during an official visit to Cuba, first drew my attention to the prospect and significance of Hugo Chavez winning the 1998 presidential election campaign in Venezuela. Es hombre militar, pero muy progresista. Creo que Chávez puede hacer una diferencia enorme en nuestra lucha para justicia en el mundo, me dijo Fidel. Immediately after his installation, we had the honor of receiving the President of Venezuela on February 10, 1999, here in Montego Bay at the 9th summit of the Group of 15 on what was his first presidential trip abroad. In his opening presentation to that summit, Hugo Chavez pledged, and I quote, to advance the Bolivarian agenda, which promote the pace and scope of integration between the nations in the Caribbean space, and to embrace initiatives which would redress the inequalities between developing countries of the South and the industrialized countries of the North. It was not long before he demonstrated the total commitment of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela to alleviate the plight of energy deficient countries within our region. The life of the San Jose Accord, which had granted concessionary oil arrangements with both Mexico and Venezuela, was expired. Hugo Chavez immediately put in place the Caracas Accord, which provided tremendous assistance to countries of our region. He was persuaded to make it inclusionary, thereby resulting in the reduction of existing tensions that had been created by age-old border disputes. But for Chavez, the Caracas Accord was only a start. When heads of state and government gathered in New York for a special convention of the UN to mark the new millennium, Hugo Chavez invited Fidel and I to a meeting in his suite at the Manhattan Hotel. At the time of high and volatile oil prices and insecure supplies, Chavez sought our views on how best to forge an energy cooperation agreement which would enhance energy security, advance regional economic integration, and foster socio-economic development for people. We, having reaffirmed the sovereign right of all nations to control and manage their natural resources, then engaged in a fruitful exchange based on our experiences of futile efforts that had been made between oil producers and consuming countries within the developing world two decades before. The triumvirate shared a common resolve to create new frontiers for trade, energy, cooperation, and human resource development. We recognized it would take considerable time for the seeds to germinate, and so we decided to remain in close and continuing contact before and during the intensive work we mandated our ministers of energy to undertake. The environment of Puerto La Cruz was exquisite for the historic ceremony. It was a sight when we could do nothing else. Those who were present will recall that before signing, we had to clear that final hurdle, which will enable the region's two energy-rich countries, Venezuela and Trinidad and Tobago, to assist energy-deficient countries of the wider region in complementary mechanisms. The PetroCaribe Energy Agreement opened a new era of collaboration to uplift and advance the economic and social conditions of people within our shores and territorial borders. Chavez was emphatic that it encompassed those who have been historically oppressed and downtrodden. Nunca olvide los pobres, he insisted. We departed Puerto La Cruz with the confidence that the unique construct and the spectacular advantages which the new regime provided would reduce the crippling effect of financial stringency and facilitate the appropriate allocation of scarce resources in all energy-deficient countries. This would allow an expansion of our social programs, building our physical infrastructure, and help us to promote education, housing, and health. Jamaica was privileged to host the second PetroCaribe Summit in Montego Bay, exactly 90 years after the great and revered liberator Simon Bolivar wrote La Carta de Jamaica on the 6th of September 1815. It was here that His Excellency Hugo Chavez, co-chairman of the summit, endorsed once again the Bolivarian vision, quote, to put into use all the resources for public prosperity to improve, educate, and perfect the new world. The constraints of time permit me to share only one humorous reflection of that occasion with you. In addition to the serious security concerns which surround the gatherings whenever certain heads are in attendance, clear warning had been given of planned political protests locally. As it transpired, whatever took place amounted to no more than moments of slight inconvenience, which Hugo Chavez found it a pleasure to overcome. Little did anyone expect that the challenge would come from a most unexpected combination which none of the security forces could prevent or control. The meeting was at the Ritz-Carlton. Accommodation was at Half Moon. We were about to retire in our separate villas at Half Moon within an area that was cordoned and under tight security when all hell broke loose. Fidel and Hugo commandeered two golf carts, and they decided to race each other all around the Half Moon compound. One was like Senna from Brazil, the other was like Lewis Hamilton. The poor security people didn't know what to do. They've managed to commandeer a few carts, scrambling them, but they could not catch up with Chavez and Castro as they went all around. How did we get them to stop? It was Simon Bolivar's birthday. And at 10 o'clock, they called and said they wanted a cake for the occasion. The cake arrived at 12 o'clock, and that is when the race of the golf carts ceased. As we celebrate the 10th anniversary of our Montego Bay summit, how do we best commemorate the legacy of this great Bolivarian disciple, and how do we perpetuate his dream? Madam Prime Minister, President Maduro, as co-chair of this summit, permit me to share with you an enterprise Chavez and I twice discussed. We wanted to build in Jamaica the land where Simon Bolivar wrote his summons of inspiration to the people of the Americas, a tertiary education which would offer specialist education in the fields of language, sports, culture, tourism, environment, maritime training, and nursing. Work on the discipline and design has already reached the embryonic stage for what would become now the Hugo Chavez Academy. This would expose the sons and daughters of Simon Bolivar, Jose Marti, Toussaint Louverture, and Marcus Garvey to develop fluency in language and hone the skills which blend our economic development and different cultures. Despite our financial restrictions, I believe you, the leaders who gather here, can marshal the monetary and academic resources to build an institution of higher learning. Let it stand as an enduring testimony to Hugo Chavez, who in his short sojourn on our planet did indeed make a monumental difference on which this and succeeding generations must build. Venceremos.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, a video presentation in tribute to His Excellency Hugo Rafael Chavez Frias.
He was born July 8, 1954, and died March 5, 2013. Only 58 years, but a life that left an indelible mark on international politics.
His assistance to developing countries in the region is beyond obvious tangible value.
Born into a working-class family in Sabaneta, Barinas, Venezuela, Hugo Chavez would become a career military officer in his Latin American homeland. But dissatisfied with the conditions of the peace country, Chavez sought politics as a means of implementing the reforms he deemed necessary.
He was passionate about his people, his country, and his mission to serve, especially in the interests of the poor, the vulnerable, and the dispossessed.
He formed and led the Fifth Republic Movement political party in 1997. And remained at its head in 2007 when it merged with other parties to form the United Socialist Party of Venezuela, which Chavez also led until his death. Hugo Chavez was elected president of Venezuela in 1998 and would retain that position in his subsequent elections. His tenure was marked by a series of reforms designed to increase the rights of marginalized groups in Venezuela and strengthen the country's economic standing. Hugo Chavez's reputation on the world stage was mixed. He was a determined supporter of Latin American and Caribbean cooperation, one of its most tangible results being the PetroCaribe agreement.
Today, we, the nations of the Americas, proudly claim a great victory through the historic landmark PetroCaribe Energy Cooperation Agreement.
Jamaica was one of 13 Caribbean countries signed on to the PetroCaribe Agreement with Venezuela in 2005. 18 countries are now members of the initiative that was conceived to alleviate the burden of rising oil prices and its negative impact on Caribbean countries. As the fifth largest oil exporter, Venezuela agreed to provide signatories with oil on preferential payment conditions.
Que andamos en el camino de la conservación, de la sobrevivencia en primer lugar, y luego del progreso, el desarrollo, la vida, la gloria.
So we are on the same path, the path of preserving our nations, conserving our nations, progressing, developing, founding peace and glory.
And now, His Excellency Salvador Valdez Mesa, Vice President of the Council of State, Republic of Cuba.
Estimada Primera Ministra de Jamaica, la más honorable Portia Simpson Miller. Estimado Presidente de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela, compañero Nicolás Maduro Moro. Estimados jefes de Estado y de gobierno de
PetroCaribe.
Tranquilo.
We have just marked the 10th anniversary of the PetroCaribe agreement, and 19 countries are already part of this unprecedented model of cooperation in solidarity. PetroCaribe has been the most efficient pillar of energy security in the region. and has contributed to the reduction of our asymmetries and the social and economic development of our peoples. This has only been possible thanks to the Bolivarian and Chavista revolution of Venezuela, its vocation for solidarity and cooperation, respect for self-determination and the sovereignty of peoples, and in particular to the extraordinary generosity and profound vocation for integration of the unforgettable President Hugo Rafael Chavez Frias. In times like these, when there is so much instability in the world's oil markets, the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela set a vigorous example of altruism to the entire world and has made and continues to make an immense effort to maintain the supplies of crude and its derivatives under very difficult circumstances, and avoiding any modification to the conditions established in the Act of Incorporation of the organization, the reason why it deserves our deepest recognition and gratitude. 10 years later, PetroCaribe has become a mechanism of cooperation which, like any other, can show concrete results. Its achievements deserve to be known in all latitudes, because if all countries that own energy resources or resources of any other sort would do the same as Venezuela is doing, we would live in a more just, more developed, more equitable, more supportive, and more peaceful planet. The PetroCaribe agreement is a new energy cooperation mechanism in Latin America and the Caribbean, not only in terms of the number of countries that are part of it, but also due to the energy supply and compensation system, which go beyond the mere commercial exchange. It was created not only with the purpose of guaranteeing a reliable oil supply and a financial scheme with preferential conditions, but also with the purpose of contributing to the social and economic development of signatory countries. This has been the mechanism generating more positive transformations and integration in the Caribbean. Without it, our countries, especially our CARICOM small island sister nations, would not have been able to resist either the economic and social situation derived from the international deep economic crisis affecting us since the year 2008. Any attempt to discredit or destroy this mechanism in exchange for doubtful offers has to be faced with determination, since it can only lead to greater dependence, destabilization, and division in our region. Finally, I would like to evoke the last proclamation written by Simon Bolivar, written before his death on December 10, 1830, in Santa Marta, Colombia, in which the liberator urged us to work for the invaluable good of unity, having as a sole purpose the consolidation of our unity, the defense of the independence, the social achievements, and the happiness of our nations, whose boundaries were expanded by José Martí to include the entire humankind. PetroCaribe, a most cherished Bolivarian treasure, has been part of our struggle for unity, independence, development, the well-being and happiness of our peoples. Let us defend it today and forever. Thank you very much. Let's defend this in the proclaim of Latin America and the Caribbean as a zone of peace, adopted in the second summit of CELAC, celebrated in La Habana in January 2014. Thank you, Jamaica,
por habernos acogido con tu espléndida hospitalidad
durante estos días, como antes hiciste con Simón Bolívar, con Antonio Maceo, con José Martí y otros insignes próceres de nuestra independencia. Gracias, Venezuela, por tu generosa solidaridad. Muchas gracias.
And now we turn our attention to the cultural stage, and we prepare for a Jamaican group that has been performing for 41 years, originally from Westmoreland, but these days they're based here in Montego Bay, St. James. They're going to treat us to traditional folk songs and traditional dances, an award-winning group that has represented Jamaica at home and abroad. Please welcome the Hatfield Cultural Group. Comes from the group Raudal, Force of Water. It's a Venezuelan instrumental group, music, traditional music, formed back in 2004, the 18th of November 2004. Representatives of the National Youth and Children's System of Orchestra and Chorales of Venezuela, Venezuelan musical youth of the Venezuela of today. And they're going to be performing a few items. The first, Señor Hao, Una Guara, Guara, see? Alma Llanera y Pajarillo. So, un momento. Here they come. Let's hear it for Raudal.
What a way to welcome His Excellency Nicolas Maduro Moros, President of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela.
Buenas noches, queridos compatriotas caribeños. Santísima, querida amiga,
dear friend,
Primera Ministra,
Prime Minister Portia Simpson Miller, dear Prime Ministers, here President, Presidents, heads of delegation as well, of our brother countries of the Caribbean here present, 19 countries are here present that are part of this PetroCaribe organization. Dear and always remembered by Commander Chavez, Prime Minister Patterson, always, he always had special warmth for Commander Hugo Chavez. He always remembered him as one of the minds and of the hearts that were able to give birth to this project of PetroCaribe. Testimony that you have shared with us of the what was existed in the last 10 years and how this process was created and how it evolved, how it was born, how exactly was this process, which was the 6th of September, when there was a signing for the first time, the birth of the agreements of energy cooperation of PetroCaribe. And today, we have had a summit that is of great relevance. Decisions have been taken there based on the successful experience of the PetroCaribe model. It is a model based on solidarity. It is a model of protection of our peoples, for the protection of our peoples. It is a model of cooperation for the liberation and for development of our nations as well. And it would be impossible that in the world, current world, that exists a model of these with these characteristics without having opponents to it, or detractors, or those who would like that it not exist. We remember this in the summit, it was mentioned there, of since the first day of the birth of our PetroCaribe, there were already voices that were detracting us, prophets of fatality, prophets of disaster, announcing then the non-viability and the impossibility and the damage that PetroCaribe was going to do to our people. It's been 10 years building a new truth, building a new history, and that new truth shines today in the light of the Caribbean above and beyond all of the things that pretended to be said and proclaimed and to be done against this beautiful and generous project. And we, the Bolivarians, who believe in God, we have to say this very Christian project that PetroCaribe is. It is a Christian project then. We have made a balance also of the achievements, the direct achievements made as per energy stability, of the direct and indirect objectives as per economic, fiscal, financial stability achieved, also of the achievements that are tangible as per social stability, social progress, the official figures of ECLAC show that there has been a growth of 26% of the GDP of the PetroCaribe. It is the highest of any organization or region of the world today, that is, of countries of the South, here, of southern countries, which is an increase of the index of development, urban development, of access to goods and services, social services, to education, to health as well. They have all increased. It has impacts of PetroCaribe in the social part of our PetroCaribe countries is evident in each and every country. And I was enjoying the music right now with the president of Haiti, a good singer and a good dancer, a good musician as well he is, this man. And I feel happy, and I have to say it right here, vis-a-vis the struggles that Haiti has lived. It has had vengeances, historical vengeances and invasions by the empire. The earthquake of 2010, and also a year and a half ago, I visited Haiti, and I was able to see for myself how our sister Haiti country has achieved a level of advancement based on social balance, which is evident in the streets, in the faces of the children there, in the coexistence of the family. What a great debt do we have with them, the sons of Bolivar with Haiti. And thanks to our commander, Hugo Chavez, and with PetroCaribe, we have paid part of the moral debt that we have with them, as well as ethical and spiritual debt that we have with our sister Republic of Haiti. These are evident, it is evident then, the impacts, the economic, social, energy impacts of these first 10 years. But I believe more important is what is to be done to consolidate the sovereignty and secure energy security.
de diversas fuentes,
from different sources,
con inversiones solidarias,
with solidary investments made, adapted to the possibilities and needs of our countries. We cannot transform the emergence of new sources of energy in new businesses in order to ransack our countries. No, we can't go back to the past, to that. PetroCaribe has to give stability, energy stability, and investments to be done, and also take in a step towards a solidary heading and benefit, mutual benefits for our peoples. It has to go that way. We have to advance in the construction of the economic zone that today has decided to create a Council of Economy of PetroCaribe, and we should make a great effort, dear ministers here present, dear heads of government as well, heads of state, leaders of the Caribbean as well, so that that Council of Economy be at the face and have a colossal task before it of the next few years to do, and of this decade that we have stated, 2015-2025, to achieve this, to transform then the economic, commercial reality as well as the financial one of all of the Caribbean in the next 10 years to create a powerful economic zone in the Caribbean region. Likewise, it has been tested that to advance towards a plan, a social plan, towards a plan of social protection of our peoples of the Caribbean, of protection of education, of public health, the right to food, the right to study, because our youth that go to universities that correspond with the great planners of development that we have made. So there are many things that have to be done yet, dear sister and friend, Prime Minister Portia Simpson. It's been 10 years where, and 10 years ahead of us where we will have great challenges that will demand much of us, great efforts. Minister Patterson, for example, Prime Minister, so we will need a lot of political will to go ahead with these plans in the future. We will have to have a lot of unitary, and we have to be united. It will demand that we transform ourselves all together and amongst ourselves in a great shield of protection as brothers, as one soul family that we are, the right to live, each one of us, in our political regimes, of our models of society that we have. It is the time of new independence to be achieved that will be is consolidated bit by bit. It is the hour of the new union. Our Commander Chavez, who was a founder of the new utopia of Latin America, he would say, with Bolivar, it is the hour of the non-independence, the end is the same, and will always be new, the independence that was said by Bolivar 200 years ago in these lands. It will always be new when it is to construct ours, the dignity, our own identity, our pride of being what we are. We are Caribbean people, of being Latin Americans as well, of being ourselves, Americans here. And we said that in a meeting, a private meeting that was held, that even though it's true that PetroCaribe has been a shield vis-a-vis different threats of the financial crisis, for example, of the food crisis and energy crisis as well, even though it's true that there's much to be done yet, but it is also true that when we see ourselves in the mirror of what is happening in the Mediterranean area, for example, what has happened to our brothers of Africa, what they are living today, and the historical migration and the humanitarian crisis that they live there due to migrations in Africa. The humanitarian crisis that is living right now by Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan right now. Countries that in the last 10 years, in the same historical time that PetroCaribe has created, has prosperity and has advanced. There are countries that have had bombardments, destruction, and wars in that same 10-year time frame. And then we see the results of this, of the capitalist models that exist that do not want anything with human beings. Then we see the results of the conflicts that took to war, taking to wars, of control of wars. They're the results of the conquering, trying to conquer those nations. So it is good that the powerful of the world see themselves in that mirror, see themselves there reflected, and some of them with maybe a ray of light that's sent by our Creator God, maybe from the bottom of their heart, they can say, thank you, God, that they exist, that PetroCaribe exists in our Caribbean. Is our Caribbean of peace and of coexistence. It is not the Mediterranean of hunger, of pain, of abject poverty that they're living. No, today we have a Caribbean with hope. We have a Caribbean today that has a future. Today we have a Caribbean that has learned to walk on its own legs and to think itself and to create its own present and to construct its own future. We have to take care of that. We have to take the foundational work of Hugo Chavez, the foundational work of our Hugo of Fidel Castro Ruz, as well as the foundational plan of this man who is that said that a Prime Minister Peterson, that possible things can be done. The generation that today has the conduction of this historical process. So we have to be careful with that, and we have to impose our majority will of work, prosperity, of unity, so that the Caribbean in the next 10, 20, even 50 years, 100 years, continue to take steps in its own road of life and of prosperity. Thank you very much for this homage to Commander Hugo Chavez. Thank you very much to Jamaica. And let's continue together with the word
única que debe pronunciar nuestros labios. Sigamos juntos venciendo. Buenas noches. Gracias.
And now, the Prime Minister of Jamaica, the Most Honorable Portia Simpson Miller.
Master of Ceremony. Your Excellency, President Nicolas Maduro and Dr. Celia Flores de Maduro, other heads of state and government, the Most Honorable Percival James Patterson, former Prime Minister, members of the Cabinet of Jamaica, visiting ministers of government, Your Worship, the Mayor, and I see two mayors present, members of the Diplomatic and Consular Corps, visiting delegations, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I extend a warm Jamaican welcome to all our visitors. Welcome to Jamaica, our homeland, with a proud history of support for the struggles of freedom-loving peoples all over the world as they pursue political and economic independence. History records that it was Jamaican of Maroon heritage by the name of Bookman who fanned the flames of freedom in neighboring Haiti and created the foundations for the first independent nation of Latin America and the Caribbean in 1804. It is the safe haven which Jamaica provided for the great liberator Simon Bolivar, which provides the context for this year's 200th anniversary celebration of Bolivar's revolutionary writings contained in the Carta de Jamaica. It is in the spirit of the continuing search for economic solutions that I welcome you to the complete resort, Montego Bay, and the venue of the first PetroCaribe Summit 10 years ago. Montego Bay is full of memories in the history of the Caribbean region's march from colonialism to self-determination. It was here at the Montego Bay Conference in 1947 that the idea of the regional university, the University of the West Indies, was born. It was here in 1947 that Caribbean nations first experimented with the regional integration project in the form of the West Indian Federation. Today, we recall that historic gathering of some 68 years ago in this city when an earlier generation of Caribbean leaders sought to prepare their countries and peoples for the new world then emerging after the Second World War. It was a new world with the prospect of freedom from colonial rule and the hope of economic independence. Today, we reaffirm that the vision of unity and the economic independence that characterized the birth of the Caribbean community continues to underlie and inspire the objective of PetroCaribe. It is with great pride and personal satisfaction, therefore, that I join you this evening in commemorating the 10th anniversary of the PetroCaribe Agreement. This is indeed a momentous occasion, as it was here in the city of Montego Bay, 10 years ago, that we first embraced the institutional arrangements for this visionary initiative. On the occasion of the 10th anniversary of the PetroCaribe Energy Cooperation Agreement, I commend the facility for its tremendous contribution to advancing the sustainable development of our countries of the Caribbean and Latin American region. This occasion presents an invaluable opportunity to reflect on and celebrate the advances of the last 10 years and to chart a path forward for this landmark South-South Cooperation Agreement. Our meeting today highlights the unwavering commitment of the government and people of Venezuela to the well-being of the peoples of the Caribbean and Latin America. We salute them for their proven commitment to the economic stability of the region and their selfless solidarity with brothers and sisters in our oil import dependent countries. Our meeting today underscores the pledge of the countries of the region to support each other as we explore available options for building our economies and securing the development of our people. It is a welcoming coincidence of history that we also meet against the backdrop of the 200th anniversary of Simon Bolivar's stay in Kingston in 1815 at the height of the Spanish-American struggle for independence. This sojourn provided that great Spanish-American hero with the inspiration for stirring the collection of liberation writing that has come to be known as La Carta de Jamaica, the Jamaica letter, written on September 6, 200 years ago. My brother and friend, President Maduro, the crowning honor is your visit to Jamaica and that of other regional heads of government in the year that we celebrate the 50th anniversary of diplomatic relations between Jamaica and the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. The Bolivarian vision for the freedom, cooperation, and integration of the peoples of the Americas ignited a passion for another noble son of Venezuela, President Hugo Chavez. It was the dream of our friend Hugo Chavez to improve the social, economic, and overall quality of life of the people of the region. That mission continues to be courageously advanced by you, President Maduro. His vision is being fulfilled through the ongoing PetroCaribe Agreement. This enduring legacy of Hugo Chavez lives on. And I want to pause to also recognize the contribution and the work of our son, the Most Honorable P.J. Patterson, former Prime Minister of Jamaica. I am pleased to announce that Jamaica will join other nations of the region in cementing his name in the annals of our history in a suitable and permanent way. Hugo Chavez. The PetroCaribe Agreement continues to ensure the energy security of the countries within our region, promote social and economic development, and foster greater trade and other forms of cooperation. A fundamental objective of the partnership is to promote higher levels of development in order to fulfill the needs and aspirations of our peoples and improve their quality of life. There have been many noteworthy accomplishments under the PetroCaribe Agreement over these 10 years, including the stable supply of energy resources, the provision of concessional financing to support development priorities in our countries, and the acquisition, upgrade, and refurbishment of energy infrastructure across our region. The establishment of the PetroCaribe Development Fund in 2006 has been an integral part of Jamaica's thrust to ensure the proper management of the proceeds from the PetroCaribe Agreement and the allocation of projects approved under the arrangement. Ladies and gentlemen, the fund's investments have been transformative in their positive impact on the Jamaican economy, including the expansion of Jamaica's road and highway network, improving our mining infrastructure, financing small and micro enterprises, supporting the revolving students' loan fund, modernizing of the Norman Manley International Airport in Kingston, the upgrading of our port infrastructure, and advancing land ownership for our people through the land administration project. Since the inception of the PCDF, more than 4.6 billion Jamaican dollars have been invested in projects for social intervention, employment creation, culture, and education. I would expect to hear you say something thanks to the government and people of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. The Simon Bolivar Cultural Center, which we will officially declare open in Kingston tomorrow, stands as a monument to the cultural investments made possible by PetroCaribe and to the lasting bonds of friendship between Jamaica and Venezuela. Ladies and gentlemen, the increased membership of the PetroCaribe Agreement to 19 countries underscores the wide acceptance of this initiative as a powerful tool to promote the development and unity of the region. This arrangement has better equipped small developing countries to face global challenges while improving the well-being of the people of the region. The PetroCaribe Agreement has fostered a deepening and broadening of the integration process within the region and has strengthened the bonds of friendship between Venezuela and PetroCaribe partner countries. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, today the future of the PetroCaribe Agreement is infused with hope and even greater possibilities. The establishment of the PetroCaribe Economic Zone and the Plan of Action for Hunger Eradication and Poverty are two major initiatives currently underway that are poised to strengthen the economic, cultural, social, and productive foundations of partner countries. These developments provide a clear indication of the expansion of PetroCaribe beyond its energy focus to embrace critical issues facing the broader development agenda of the region. Ladies and gentlemen, I commend to you this evening the words of Jamaica's first national hero and global advocate of economic self-reliance, the Right Excellent Marcus Mosiah Garvey, who said that a people without knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots. Today, as we meet, we water the roots of regional cooperation. Today, we honor the legacy of our shared history and culture. Thus, our commemoration of the 10th anniversary of the PetroCaribe Agreement is timely. Acknowledgement of our accomplishments over this period must be accompanied by an unshakable resolve to fashion the economic independence and regional cooperation advanced by our early leaders and manifested in the pursuit of unity, solidarity, security, peace, and prosperity within our region. Let us, in our time, live the vision that Bolivar foretells in the Jamaica letter when he said, "More than anyone, I desire to see the Americas fashioned into the greatest nation in the world, greatest not so much by virtue of her area and wealth as by her freedom and glory." It is in this glorious freedom as sovereign states, bound together by the mission of economic independence for our peoples, that we now fashion the future of the Americas. As we advance to realize the objectives we set in 2005, we remain motivated by the vision of Commander Hugo Chavez. Inspired by the ideals of Simon Bolivar, encouraged by the commitment of our current leaders, and fortified by the support of our peoples, Jamaica will continue to actively engage our partners through the PetroCaribe Agreement in order to further consolidate the successes of the last 10 years and to chart new paths in the years ahead for a better Jamaica and a more secure and prosperous Caribbean and Latin American region. Long live President Maduro. Long live PetroCaribe. Viva the vision of President Hugo Chavez. Long live the timeless principles of freedom championed by Simon Bolivar. Today, I salute the government and people of Venezuela and all the leaders and people of our countries of the Caribbean and Latin America. I thank you.
And that concludes this evening's commemorative ceremony to mark the 10th anniversary of the PetroCaribe Agreement. Please remain standing for the departure of the official party as they repair to the courtyard for the Prime Minister's reception and cultural presentation.
Gracias.